Welcome to Amazing Mind, the HMI web TV talk show that introduces all sorts of interesting people and topics related to subconscious behavior. My name is Lisa Mackenberg, hypnotherapist, HMI instructor, and host. Today we have an amazing guest who's going to talk to us about the psychology of boys so that we can nurture the boys in our private practice and the boys in our lives. Please help me welcome Hava Rahimian. Well, Hava, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And then you're a licensed psychotherapist, an LMFT. LMFT.
Yes.
And you have a vibrant practice here in Los Angeles, California.
Yes, I do. Mm-hmm.
One of the things you told me you specialized in is helping parents raise boys.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about what are the statistics about the boys in our lives here in the 21st century?
Well, I would love to share these statistics, and I have to tell you, when I first read them, I was astounded by them, and quite disturbing.
Yes.
So about 95% of juvenile homicides are committed by boys.
By boys, you're talking about 19 and younger?
Yes.
Wow.
Because they're juvenile, so yeah, under the age of 18.
Mm-hmm.
Boys account for almost 9 out of 10 alcohol and drug law violations. And suicide is the third leading cause of death among boys in their mid to late teens.
Why are boys so prone to these kinds of violent behaviors?
Well, there's differences amongst boys and girls. It's obvious. But there's two main biological differences between them that impact development and behavior. And we're talking about behavior when we're talking about these statistics. The first one is that girls' verbal abilities come in much earlier than boys. They mature much faster than boys do. And they girls actually start to speak earlier than boys, and they speak more frequently. And you go into any preschool, you'll notice this. It's very, very obvious. The other thing that is the biological difference is that boys are much more physically active than girls are. They need to run and jump and climb and move.
Yes.
Whereas girls can be perfectly happy sitting, playing with their dolls, you know. And of course, there are boys that are not this way and girls that aren't, but we're talking about, you know, general.
I notice it in the mommy and me that I teach. I also notice it among my own children.
Yeah.
We used to have a joke that if you can't find Max, look up in a tree.
Yeah.
And you'll find him.
That's right. And with my kids, I have 2 6-year-old boys, twin boys, and if you can't find them, they're probably outside shooting basketball.
Yes.
Or kicking a ball around or something. So
yes.
Very active.
Uh-huh.
Very active. So that can really help explain some of these statistics. The rest of the differences between development and behavior have a lot to do with how, as a society, we are almost programming our boys.
What do you mean by that?
Well, we live in a very macho, kind of stereotypically macho world.
Even now?
Even now.
We think about that like with John Wayne in the 50s and 60s?
No, even now, even though we have this new buzzword that's coming out called the sensitive, I think it's a sensitive male.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And that, even though that's coming out and people are talking a little bit about this, you know, ideology, there's still a lot of stereotypical male behaviors and male ideologies that are exhibited in TV, in movies, even in your own homes.
Can you describe some of them?
Well, the idea that a man is supposed to be very tough and very stoic and, you know, doesn't cry and, you know, those ideas, they kind of get passed down from your own group, you know, upbringing to, you know, passed down into your kids, as well as watching shows, you know, basketball players acting very tough.
Yes.
You know, rock stars being those angry, you know, tough rock stars.
And sure.
Doesn't give you much of a spectrum.
So now,
boys.
In the 21st century, why are we seeing more suicides, more crime, more violence, especially the suicides?
Well, you know, I think that it has a lot to do with the fact that these boys have no way of expressing their emotion. They have no way of even putting words to it.
Sure. So, unlike the girls.
Yeah, they don't have language for it. So, you know, if a little boy is experiencing frustration or anger, It's mm-hmm. not, he might act out physically, mm-hmm. but sometimes we don't necessarily take a moment to give him language for it so that he can express it verbally and not act out either onto society or himself.
Sure.
And harm himself.
So you're talking about what the boys become suggestible to, what they're watching on TV and learning in the family. Where's the societal pressure? Where is it coming in?
Like I said, I think that a lot of it is being exposed to violent video games.
Video games, because that's new. How are the video games impacting boys?
Well, I don't know if you know, your boys play video games. But
Halo, the shoot 'em up.
Yeah.
The one where they steal a car. I can't remember the name of it.
There's
now.
So many. There's so many of these video games, and some of them are fine, uh-huh. you know, but some of them are incredibly Call to Duty, Call of Duty.
That's yes. Yes.
Incredibly violent. A lot to do with, you know, getting the girl and shooting everybody. And, you know, it's so they do this. And the more they do this, this becomes kind of a prototype to them mm-hmm. as to what a man and what a boy is.
Yes.
And so there's really no other alternative out there to show them otherwise.
Sure. Going back to research, what have some of the studies shown around this?
Well, there was this one actual study done that was very interesting. They took mm-hmm. a series of boys and they asked them how much they agreed with these following statements. It is essential for a guy to get respect from others. A guy will lose respect if he talks about his problems. A young man should be physically tough even if he's not big. And mm-hmm. a husband should never do housework. So those were the four statements that they were asked to agree on, uh-huh. you know, on a spectrum. And what they found was very interesting. They found that the more the boys agreed with these statements, the more the statements actually corresponded to their own values and ideologies about what they believe a man is.
Yes.
And those beliefs actually led to behaviors like more drinking, more drug use, unprotected sex, getting dismissed from school or suspended from school, and forcing or tricking a girl into having sex.
Wow.
So there's a very strong correlation between what they believe and how they behave.
Sure. And I'm going to take some of these one at a time, especially that first one, mm-hmm. that it's important. I'm going to read it exactly.
Yeah.
It's essential for a guy to get respect from others. Right. And I certainly hear when, and my sons are 14, mm-hmm. that when there's a fight, it's because someone felt dissed.
Uh-huh. That's right.
That's a colloquialism for disrespected. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Instead of just saying, oh, gosh, what a jerk.
Yeah.
It was, he disrespected me, therefore it is necessary to have a confrontation and to command that respect right. with a physical altercation.
That's right.
Is that what you're seeing too?
Absolutely. That's right. And this idea that, you know, he will lose respect mm-hmm. if he shows any vulnerability, if he shows any kind of emotion mm-hmm. or any kind of humanness to him. It's almost like they expect them to be these robots and have no emotion and just kind of go yes. through life without, you know, any softness to them.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I want to go to this last one too. Mm-hmm. A husband should not do housework. Now, this is, we're asking boys.
That doesn't work in my house. Okay.
You know what? There's a new term. I'll teach it to you. It's called chornography.
Oh,
instead of pornography, chornography, uh-huh. which shows... Yes, that when men, husbands, uh-huh. Help to relieve and take some of the household duties, the woman is more relaxed and has more time, and therefore is more receptive mm-hmm. to intimacy.
Absolutely. I mean, you ask any woman what she wants her husband to do for her, you know, some will say, you know, give me flowers, some will say, you know, take me on a nice dinner, but a lot of them will say, actually, you know, can you just do the dishes?
How about pick up the fork off the floor that you dropped last Tuesday?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. Or, you know, anything. Leave your clothes on the floor. I mean, these are things that you teach children, boys, from a very young age to
sure.
do these things.
So when a boy doesn't see his father doing that, he believes that there's something unmanly
yes.
about doing the dishes.
That's right. That's right.
around this, especially about not having language to talk about a boy's internal world, there's all kinds of new ways to communicate. And I tell you, Hava, I have very mixed feelings about video chatting, Facebook. When my boys do not talk intimately to me like this. This is so last decade.
It's hard for them. It's hard.
They talk with their intimacy with texting or typing. Is this a good thing? Does this allow boys to talk about their internal worlds in a safe way to other boys? What do you think on this?
You know, I think that that's a great question, and I think that it's very appropriate for the times. Everybody has a phone or something that they, you know, some electrical gadget that's connecting them to other people. On one hand, it does provide connection.
Yes.
It does. I think that, like anything else, like video games and movies and TV and whatnot, it needs to be limited in a way so that the boys and other kids in general understand what real connection with another person needs.
Yes, and that gets back to our statement that a young man can trick or physically coerce a woman into being sexual.
Yes.
That if we can find a way to connect in moderation and not talk about the pressure from society, but true intimate connection, that our boys are going to be better off.
Absolutely. I mean, this is all, you know, all of these things we're talking about really set the stage for future development and future connections with people and having healthy relationships.
You know what, Hava? I'm going to ask us to hold that thought right now. Because now that we've looked at the research, the second half of our program today, I want to talk about what we as hypnotherapists and parents and teachers, what we can do about it to nurture the boys in our world. So we are going to take a short break, but please stay tuned. Because when we come back, we're going to talk more about the psychology of boys. And our second half, we'll talk about what we can do about it to nurture, well, the boys and the men in our lives. We'll be right back.